first service. I love first service because I'm not a morning person, so I like being around you. You're like special people. My name is Trish Davis. I'm one of the pastors here at Hope City, and I'm telling you, we have been praying. We have been dreaming. We've been praying a lot more. We have been investigating. We've been reading, just doing everything we can to really prepare for this series called Fight. And as Justin said, we know that today we're not going to solve, even in this series, solve every mental health issue. In fact, that's really not our goal. Our goal with this series is to begin a conversation, a dialogue. And we hope that it's a conversation that continues throughout the lifetime of this church. And so with that, I just thought before we dove in, I would just like to pray together and just invite God into this space. So let's pray. Father, I just thank you for your word. I thank you that the church is a place where we can become before we believe. We can come if we never believe. It's a place of safety and belonging, and a place ultimately to find hope. And so, Father, we just pray in this whole series that you would show up for each of us individually. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, I don't know about you, but I am not a big fan of boxing. You know, like, there's these moments where, like, there's a big fight that's about to happen, and you see previews for it, and you gotta pay special TV to be able to watch it. And in my house of boys, like, boxing is a thing. In fact, my son Elijah loves to box. He has his own bag. He has his own gloves. But I don't really get it. But being a boy mom, the rite of passage of being a boy mom is watching over and over again every single Rocky movie, right? Like, have you seen Rocky? There's like six of them. When Rocky came out with number four, we were like, oh, really, dude? Come on. You know, we're like, how can you extend this even more? And then we watch it. We're like, yes, you know. Then recently, to extend the whole Rocky theme, and if you've never watched Rocky, I'll pray for you. That's really weird. But Rocky is this theme of like Rocky Balboa. He's this Philly dude, you know, who like has everything against him to become a fighter. And then we watch him in the first movie, him train and him become amazing. In fact, there's this epic scene in the first movie where as he's training, he finishes his training and then he runs up the stairs of a Philadelphia building. I think it may be the State Building. And it's that famous music, dun, 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 dun. Like, you know, like, I have the time, he's going to nail this. And then when he gets to the top, it's like utter success. And it became so iconic that moms like me get excited when we hear that theme music. In fact, we all have this dream that we're gonna run up those stairs, right? And we're gonna be like Rocky and conquer our fight. A couple years ago, Justin and I had the opportunity to speak in Philadelphia. And so we went to go find the statue. And this is us. But Rocky used to be at the top of the stairs, but he got demoted. We were like, what happened? But so then you have all the Rocky movies. Then Creed came out. How many of you have seen Creed? And let's be honest, when Creed came out, we all did the biggest eye roll. We're like, dude, let the storyline die, right? And then we are introduced to this new character, Adonis Creed, played by one of my favorites, Michael B. Jordan. It's not a part of my message, but it's worth watching just for that. And again, this like whole storyline starts to unfold. And it becomes a worldwide sensation. And I think not because of boxing, because of the theme. There's this theme throughout all the Rocky movies of someone who is the underdog. Someone who probably doesn't deserve to be in the ring. And what we learn most is not just about the wins Rocky has. And we don't just learn about the wins that Adonis Creed has. The biggest takeaway is the training. Like, we see him do the hard physical work of the training, and not just the physical, the storyline is all the emotional, all the mental. It's fascinating. If you've never watched it, go watch it this afternoon. You have permission. Watch TV, right? But we have got to experience like a real live Rocky here at Hope City. A gal who calls Hope City home, her name is Teresa Wyrick. And Teresa, she will tell you, she's like a little itty-bitty thing to begin with, but she was never like, she didn't run triathlons or wasn't like really big into the race world, but she felt like she was struggling with some just anxiety, some just feeling like she's been off. And so she started exercising and realizing how exercise was really healthy for her mentally. And she began to challenge herself. And this past year, she decided that she was going to become an Ironman athlete. I don't know who does that, but I didn't wake up and go, you know what, I think I'm going to be an Ironman today. But she just had it in her mind, you know what, I'm going to push myself. And so we've got to watch in real time her become an Ironman. She began 10 months ago on this journey, and we've watched her like via Instagram when she comes on church. She's come to church during this 10-month journey with a boot on, and we're like, oh no. And she's shared with us just how emotional and physically taxing the training has been. But what's been so cool is to see her like persevere, like how she's empowered herself with knowledge of how to get healed up from that injury, the food that she should be eating because she's already teeny tiny, but like how to create muscle and not just lose weight. It's been so inspiring. And then I think last month she ran her race. And so I asked her, I'm like, will you tell me kind of all that was involved? What is involved in an Ironman? And she says, Ironman Chattanooga. I'm like, seriously, isn't there like an Ironman Midwest where it's like flat? She decided to go to Chattanooga, and I don't know if you know anything about Chattanooga, but it's like, it's just topography. It's just mountain. It's not hills. It's mountain, y'all. She says it was 144.6 miles total race. That is like us all deciding to stand up and swim, run, and bike our way to Louisville, Kentucky today. Like, I just can't even fathom it. She says, not only is it 144.6 miles, but it has to be completed in 16.5 hours. She wrote it like that's normal. I've never done anything for 16.5 hours, ever. She goes on to say that it's comprised of a 2.4 mile swim, 116 mile bike ride, and a full marathon, which is 26.2 miles. And I said, well, what was your longest training regimen? She said, the longest that I trained was 8 hours on a Saturday with just a 100-mile bike ride, no big deal, in a two-mile swim. And then the next day on Sunday, she had a 30-mile bike ride and a 20-mile run. Now listen, if I run more than 13.1 miles, there better be someone standing with a medal to hand to me, right? Like, I'm not running just 20 miles. And I said, well, what is your training collectively over the 10 months? This was staggering. She said, I trained for the Ironman in 10 months. In total, my number since January is that I have swam over 140 miles. 140 miles. She said over 3,500 miles of biking. Y'all, that is like she biked from Miami, Florida, all the way to Seattle, Washington in 10 months. Like, I can't even fathom it. And lastly, that she ran over 1,200 miles. It's so inspiring. I wish I had a picture of her. She's super cute. And like watching her, like in real time, her husband put up a video of her finishing the race. Like, we're all just like sobbing. You see, people like stories like Rocky and stories like Teresa, they inspire us because we see people run their race well. We see them fight for what they want. But I think the tension for all of us is that when we talk about church culture, we talk about how to fight spiritually. Right? How to fight for our faith, how to fight to be connected with God. In Western culture, we talk all the time about what it means to fight for our health, right? You could turn on the TV and it's like, lose 5 pounds in 5 minutes. Like, we do all of this knowledge. We have all of this bombarding of physical health. And in the church world, it's about spiritual health. But I don't know about you. I don't remember turning on the TV and it says, you know, hey, the commercial of the day is 5 ways to be emotionally healthy. Like, we don't talk about emotional health. In fact, if we're talking about something that has to do with emotions, it usually on the TV is about a pill that you can take. We're not really about the root of the issue. And here's the deal, is we're all emotional people. I don't know about you, but nobody taught me how to be angry. That just kind of comes naturally. Just saying. Nobody taught me how to be, you know, disappointed. Or to find joy. Nobody told me that this is how you become joyful or happy. Like, it just happens. And because it happens naturally, we just assume we naturally know what to do with them. Until. You know that moment? We all have that moment where we're like, ooh, I didn't see that coming. Where an emotion kind of takes over your body to the point you feel possessed and you say things to your mother-in-law you shouldn't say, or you say things Christmas morning. I mean, you know, you all have been there, you've said things and you're like, oh my gosh, where did that come from? For me personally, I am at my most crazy at my kids' basketball games. I don't know what happens. Like, I walk in Trisha and I walk into the gym. Like my college girlfriends call it Rosalina. It's my other personality. They make fun of me because being Hispanic, I tend to be a little spicy. And so I get Rosalina when I go inside my, you know, kids' games. And I'll never forget poor Isaiah. My son Isaiah, who is now a freshman in high school, when he was in second grade, began to play competitive basketball. Yes, this is a thing. Competitive basketball in the second grade. So it wasn't upward. Not everybody won. You knew what the score was. You didn't get stickers afterwards. You got reprimanded if you didn't follow the play. And it was intense. And I'll never forget this poor child. You guys, if you know Isaiah, he just keeps growing. Like every 5 minutes, just growth, growth, growth. And so when he was little, he would get coordinated, and then he would grow, and then he would be completely uncoordinated. It was this, like, thing that would go back and forth. So some seasons he was really good at basketball, and then he would grow. And other seasons he just couldn't figure out, like, how his torso went with his legs. And we were in a season of growth. And so this poor child traveled with the basketball every time he touched it. And there was a certain parent on an opposite team that made it his mission to make sure that everybody in the gym, including the referees, knew that this child was traveling. So he stood up and he would walk wherever Isaiah was as a second grader. And he was like, travel, travel. And I'm telling you, Southside Trisha came out. I'm like, the earrings are coming off. And my family is seeing this unfold. But instead of like stepping into my emotional breakdown, they pop popcorn and they just watch it unfold. So I get up and I'm like, I know you did not just say that to my, you know. And so then they realize it's getting a little heated and the kids are like, oh, we need to go. So I had to be removed from a second grade basketball game. Like, it's true, like, we have all these emotions. Author John Bloom, I love the way that he talks about our emotions. He says this, that our emotions are gauges, not guides. It's super powerful. I tried to condense this just to reiterate it, but I'm just going to read it because it's so powerful. He goes on to say that God designed your emotions to be gauges, not guides. They're meant to report to you, not dictate to you. The pattern of your emotions, not every like caffeine-induced or sleep-deprived one, but will give you a reading of where your hope is. Where your hope is because they are wired into what you believe and value and how much. That's why emotions like delight and affection and fear and anger and joy are so important in the Bible because they reveal what your heart loves, trusts, and fears. He's going to say, because our emotions are wired into our fallen nature, as well into our regenerated natures. In other words, he's saying, like, our story of sin that enters in the garden is part of our narrative. And then also, as we grow, the emotions change as we reach adolescence into adulthood. He goes on to say that sin and Satan have access to them and will use them to try to manipulate us to act faithlessly. That's why our emotional response to temptation can seem like an imperative. Like, you must do, rather than an indicative where here's what you're being told. And just remember, that's deceit. He goes on to say, and this is my favorite, he says, emotions aren't imperatives. They are not your boss. Right? Like, emotions are not your boss. They're indicatives. They're reports. It's why Paul wrote, let your sin therefore reign in your mortal, do not let your sin reign in your mortal body to make you obey its passion. He says, so get ready today, be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. He will make promises to and or threats against you. He will likely try and tap into your weak areas of unbelief and you may find your emotions surging in the wrong direction. When that happens, don't be overly impressed. And remember that your emotions are gauges, not guides. Let them tell you where the attack is being made so that you can fight. Fight it with the right promises. And go to a trusted friend for prayer, perspective, and counsel. In other words, in a nutshell, what he's saying is our emotions are a gauge. A gauge where we get to connect God. In other words, our emotions connect us with an emotional God. And oftentimes when we feel this emotion, we just feel it naturally, so we just kind of do whatever we want, and we end up, like, living out of our emotions. You ever been in a circumstance where you just feel, like, angst about it, and then you just carry that angst, and there was nothing really angst happening in it, but because you carried that in with you, you allowed it to dictate how that whole circumstance unfolded. And when he's saying, listen, we have an emotional God, and God uses our emotions to connect him with him. And we see this all throughout the New and Old Testament of the Bible. We see this in the life of David. We've talked a lot about David. I don't have time to unpack the stories of each of these people, but the truth is the same theme, that their emotions were real. David says in Psalm 102, he says, hear my prayer, Lord. Let my cry come to you. Do not hide your face from me in this day of my distress. Incline your ear to me. Answer me speedily in the day when I call, for my days pass like smoke and my bones burn like a furnace. My heart is struck down like grass and is withered. I forget to eat my bread. Because of my loud groaning, my bones cling to my flesh. I am like a desert owl in the wilderness, like an owl of the waste places. I lie awake, and I am like a lonely sparrow on the housetop. Like he is feeling some strong emotions. We see in Elijah, Prophet Elijah in 1 Kings, he's coming out of a really intense time, and he asks that he might die, saying, is it enough now, O Lord? Just take my life, for I am no better than my father's. And he laid down and he slept under the broom tree. And behold, an angel touched him and said to him, arise and eat. We see in the life of Hannah in 1 Samuel, Hannah wept and would not eat. She was deeply distressed and she prayed to the Lord as she wept bitterly. We see in the life of Paul, 2 Corinthians. He says, we were so utterly burdened beyond our strength that we despaired of life itself. Indeed, we felt like we had received a sentence of death. But that was to make us rely not on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. He delivered us from such deadly peril, and he will deliver us. And on him, we have set our hope that he will deliver us again. So it's this common theme that these emotions were gauges to the truth of where they were in their life circumstances, but it did not guide them. It did not dictate what they chose through it. They turned to God. And I think the most epic person in all of the Bible that we see have a place where emotions are so thick is in the life of Jesus. Jesus in Luke chapter 22, it says that he, Jesus, withdrew from them, talking about the disciples. This is before he is about to be taken captive and go to the cross. It says he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, and he knelt down and he prayed, saying, Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. And I want you to catch something here. Jesus is being very honest with his emotions. And he's taking those emotions to prayer to God. And we saw that in the life of David, in Hannah, in Elijah, that they're taking their emotions, but we don't read in each of their stories that once they took their emotions to God, then everything worked out. Everything was perfect. Except, in fact, it goes on to say that as he prays this prayer, that there appeared to him an angel from heaven strengthening him. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. You see, he had already given over to God, it didn't change his emotional state. He was in despair. In fact, it goes on to say that, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. Matthew 26 says that he said, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. And John chapter 11 says, Jesus wept. You see, our emotions connect us with an emotional God. And all of us have experienced emotions. Right? We've experienced sadness. But for some of us, sadness turns to sorrow. It's like not a one and done thing where, man, you felt sad about it and then you were able to move on, but it just hangs with you. And then that sorrow, it leads to despair. And that despair makes you withhold yourself from people. Despair brings you into this place where you think no one will understand your heart. And when you start to remove yourself from God and remove yourself from other, you get to this place of hopelessness. And that's depression. Depression is this lie that you believe that the sadness will never end, that no matter what you do, you can't find joy back. And as I was reading and just investigating the whole topic of mental health, specifically to depression, the statistics are pretty staggering. Over 300 million people worldwide struggle with depression. One in four women in the United States will be diagnosed with clinical depression. Over 2 million of our students in the United States struggle with depression. And depression makes you feel like you're alone, that no one will understand. And it's interesting, as I watch the leaves over the past few weeks, they've been amazing, haven't they? It's like the most beautiful fall that I can remember in a long time. And to know me is to know I'm a little nutty about nature. I think I'm getting worse in my older age because my family is ready for fall to be over because I'm like, look at the tree. Look at that tree. As if the tree before it is different than this tree. But I'm like, look at that tree. So now they kind of play with me and they're like, Mom, look at that tree. Like they try to beat me to the punch, but it's beautiful. And there's something amazing about living in the Midwest that we get to experience all the seasons. Like I love spring and the pretty blooms and then the rich green of summer and the warmth and then fall. It's just like, it gets epic. The trees are beautiful. But then those beautiful leaves begin to fall off and I call it in my house naked trees. Like it's the season of naked trees. And for people who struggle with depression, even seasonal depression, but clinical depression, it's like the belief that the tree has died because the leaves have fallen off and the gray skies have moved in, that somehow spring is not coming. In other words, when you struggle with depression, there's this feeling and belief that nothing will change. No matter how hard you lean in, no matter how many times you go to church, that life will not change. Your marriage will always feel distant. Your child will never respect you. Your job will always be hard and miserable. You will never get out of debt. You will never be good enough, smart enough, beautiful enough. You'll never find good, healthy friends in middle school or high school. Depression tells you that you can never be forgiven for what you've done. Depression tells you to stop fighting. It's not worth it. And at the very depth of the core of depression, you begin to believe this lie that maybe death is better than life. And here's the deal. Nobody chooses to be depressed. It's a slow drift because we're emotional people and sadness is a normal, healthy emotion. But when sadness turns to sorrow and that sorrow turns to despair and that despair turns to hopelessness, it begins to change your perspective to see truth for what it really is. And that's where I found myself this summer. In a place that I was just drifting. And many of you have been around here enough to know that our family has just been crazy town, really for the past 3 years. When we moved here to Plant Hope City, our oldest graduated from high school. I think if we would have planted like 5 years ago, I would have been in a much different season emotionally because I knew how to do elementary and middle school and high school with my kids. But when we moved here, transition after transition after transition happened. Micah graduated. Elijah became a senior, and then he graduated. And then Micah got engaged, and then we adopted. And Isaiah just kept growing, and just like he's still grown out of all of his clothes, right? You know, like so much transition. We launched the church, right? We launched the church, and we're portable. So every week, we're setting up, and we're tearing down, and then we get the gift of this building. And it's intense, and we go through construction phase, and I just found myself a couple of weeks before Micah's wedding so tired. And in my tiredness, I began to lose perspective. And in the backdrop of all of this unfolding, I was slowly watching my mama struggle with mental health. My mom is my rock. She's been my best friend for years. And I watched her slowly become a different person. And I kept thinking, in this next transition, she'll get better. In this next season of retirement, she'll get better. And she hasn't. And so right before Micah's wedding, Mike and I got into what I think is a normal, natural transitional season of life change, a big one, you know, like when you move out of your parents' house forever and ever, there's some normal grieving. But I took that grief to a whole other level. And in my tiredness, I began to think that my sadness had turned to sorrow, and my sorrow had turned to despair, and my despair turned into hopelessness, that the people I love will not love me back. In July, I got really low. And I began finding myself working late hours at the church, and I found myself not going home, but just kind of driving around, because I knew if Justin knew, I would be found out. See, nobody chooses depression. But you can choose how you fight through it. And one night I came home and I told him. And there was no major, there was no chemical imbalance, there was nothing that was major in my life. I was tired and I needed rest. And I needed that rest to get healthy perspective. But here's the deal. This is why I think you see leaders make the ultimate choice. I think this is why you see pastors specifically struggle, because depression can be embarrassing. And depression happens for all different reasons. Depression can happen because a lack of sleep. It can happen from a chemical imbalance. Depression can happen because of a situation, a divorce. There's no one lane, but it always comes back to the same thing. Depression makes you feel that you're alone and no one will ever stand. Depression makes you feel weak and damaged, like there's something wrong with you. But in my journey with my mama and my own journey, I've realized this, that depression is not a sin. Depression is not a sin, and it doesn't negate your worth, your giftedness, or your character. Let me say that again. Depression is not a sin. And for many of us, we believe the lie that if we struggle in it, somehow it negates everything. But listen, depression cannot, nor life, nor death, nor principalities, nothing can separate us from the love of God. That your worth is solidified through the cross. That even in Jesus' darkest hour, he stepped into the moment. And when he was on the cross, he took on our sin and he changed everything. That we don't need angels to attend us anymore, that we have the power of the Holy Spirit that meets us in our need. God does not wait for you to be emotionally healthy, and God does not wait for you to live out the fullness of your giftedness and character. He says, listen, I love you, period. And so as a church, what does it mean to come around people who struggle with depression? How do we begin to give truth to people to let them know, listen, your struggle is not a sin. It does not disqualify you from leading worship. It does not disqualify you from helping out in the kids area. It does not disqualify you from being a leader in this church. In fact, if God uses our emotions, we have an opportunity for that depression to draw us closer to the heart of God. And as a community of faith, the church has a unique voice to speak hope into despair and meaning into uncertainty. Y'all, we have this gift that is the church. We get to speak hope, because here at Hope City, we believe that hope changes everything. And we get to be hope bearers. We get to be hope dealers to help people see themselves beyond their depression, to give them meaning. You know, when I look back on my season in July, I'm still in shock, because I know God's word. I know the Bible from front to back. I have never wavered in my faith with him. Like, I've just not been that person. He's just always had my back through all of it. And still, I found myself there. But I had people around me who spoke hope, who spoke truth, who spoke encouragement. And so if we're going to be a community that steps into this conversation, we got to be willing to fight. We got to be willing to step into the training. And it begins with this. Hope is found in radical acceptance. Hope is found when we provide a place for people to belong before they believe. That at Hope City, we provide a place for people to struggle with depression, even when we see the truth about who they truly are. We have the opportunity to be a place
the safest place for people to fight, a place where people can lace up their gloves and know that we've got their back. We're in the ring with them. You see, radical acceptance leads people to hope, and we believe that hope in Christ changes everything. Secondly, hope is found in empowerment. And this is where we hope, as a church, we come together. There's an author, his name is Dr. Gregory Jantz. I just stumbled upon him. He's written like 30 books, but some of his books are super, I mean, they're awesome. From eating disorders to having a child who struggles with mental health issues. And you know what he says is the most powerful thing when it comes to depression that you can do for a loved one? That radical acceptance is to be empowered with the knowledge of how to step in. And you know what he says about stepping in? He doesn't say you have to become an expert. He doesn't even say you need to know the 5 happy hops to become a healthy person. He says just be present. Ask the question, what do you need today? How can I serve you? How can I help you? And even if they don't know, you keep asking over and over again. See, when we become empowered, then we begin to step into those places, not waiting for permission, but with the power of the Holy Spirit to speak truth into people's lives, because depression is not a sin. And when you're in a place of depression, you can't see that truth. What if God wants to use you to be a hope dealer, to be a hope bearer, to be empowered to step into someone's story and say, you know what? I love you. I'm with you. It's a game changer. Lastly, I want to close with this. Is that hope is found in perseverance. Hope is found in perseverance. For some of us, this is a lifelong battle. It's not a season. It's not just going to end. It's going to be until we're in heaven. But what I'm learning in my own fight is that we can win the battle every single time. That if we choose the hard work to fight, if we surround ourselves with a faith community that allows us to see the truth, perseverance is a game changer. So I want to close today with a pretty tender moment. I'm going to invite my friend Melissa Sandulo up, and if you know Melissa, I could listen to her sing the Bible to me, or I don't know, a boring book, and I would just be like, that's the best book ever. She has been a worship leader here. We love her family, her husband, and her kids. She's a singer, songwriter, and she's been on her journey of perseverance, and I just thought I would allow her to share part of her journey today.
Hello? Okay, now we're on. Hi, everybody. Hi, I'm a steady hand now. In first service, I was like, "This, you know, if you've seen Blazing Saddles, it's like, this is my steady hand, but this is my shooting hand." That's kind of how I was. That's how I was feeling in first service. I have this coin with me today, and it's probably worth about 15 cents monetarily. But it's worth my entire life to me, because I received this coin Friday after completing a partial hospitalization and intensive outpatient program for my suicidal intent. And I'm here today because I want to be, and that's a pretty big deal. I do want to offer a trigger warning for those of you who deal with depression, that my story does involve suicidal ideation and intent with planning. But again, I'm standing here because I want to be. So my story is not over, but that part of it has a happy ending. So thankful for that. I've struggled with some form of mental illness since my childhood. I didn't know what that was. Neither did my parents. I grew up believing that I should be able to pray it away, memorize scripture, and have victory over that. I want to say this, that faith and treatment do not have to be mutually exclusive. And I'm thankful for Trisha's message this morning. And I also want to preface what I'm about to talk about by saying that I do not intend in any way to downplay faith and the role that it has in our recovery. But I believed, because of how I grew up and what I was taught in the church, that my depression and my illness was the result of unchecked and unconfessed sin. That's not true. There are a lot of reasons that people are depressed. Sometimes our depression comes from external circumstances. Sometimes our depression comes from poor choices that we've made. And sometimes our brains are just broken, which is what I'm dealing with. My brain is broken. I've been diagnosed with clinical major depressive disorder. That means I will take medicine every day for the rest of my life. And I'm okay with that. I'm very okay with that. I went on medication for depression finally in my early 20s, after years and years of trying to fight it on my own, after years of believing that I was weak in spirit. And I went on my medication, I'd feel better, and I would go off of it. Because then I had a testimony that God had healed me. So I'd go off of this medication and just proclaim that I was healed, and then a few months later, I was right back down, and I felt like a failure. I could never really identify a real trigger for my depression. That made it so much harder for me. Especially more recently, I have a wonderful husband. My kids are awesome. I have a moderately successful music career. I have everything I ever wanted. But I was profoundly sad. Profoundly sad. And when my husband would see that creeping up in me, he would ask, "What's wrong? What's going on with you?" And I was like, "I don't know. I'm just really, really sad." And he'd say, "Is there something that happened?" "I don't know. I don't think so. I'm just really, really sad." "Well, do you want to talk to somebody about it?" What would I say? "I don't know what's wrong. I don't know what's wrong with me. I'm just really, really, really sad." And that's what I dealt with. 2.5 years ago, in the deepest depression that I had had to date, I began to research ways to make a suicide look like an accident. At that point in time, I was so tired of feeling sad without a reason, and I was feeling like a burden to my family. So I did some research, and I just never put anything on paper, but thought a lot about how I would go if I ever decided to go. And then I snapped out of it. I talked to my husband again about how I was feeling. He had convinced me to at least go to my medical doctor and see about changing medications. So I did. And I felt better for a little while. And over time, I had the same scenario play out several times. Just over 2 months ago, my depression was so bad that I would have 2 weeks, if I was lucky, where I would feel okay. 1 week where I felt really good, and the rest of the month was just bad. I was really in the weeds for the rest of the month. I would wake up in the morning at about a 2 out of 10, and on a decent day, I would get up to about a 4. On a great day, I would get to about a 6. But on most days, I stayed right around a 2. It affected my family. My husband felt like he had to walk on eggshells because I was tearful all the time. And there was one incident in particular where I was upset with him about something fairly innocuous. It wasn't a huge deal, but I expressed to him my feelings in that moment. I felt like my feelings were valid. And he said to me, my sweet, kind husband, who never says anything hurtful, and he was okay for him to say what he said. He said to me, sometimes I just don't know how to communicate with you because of your depression, and I don't know what's going to make you feel bad. And I saw the anguish in his eyes, and I put a pin in that conversation. And I said, okay, I get it. And in my mind, I'm ruminating, yep, I've already felt like I was a burden to my family, so I'm going to put a pin in that because that was a moment. In my depression, I feel very irritable and easily angered. And because of that, I found myself withdrawing from my children, who I love more than anything in the world. And the reason I withdrew from them is because to me it was better than losing my temper. And so I became very flat with my children and just kind of went through the motions of being their mom. And that was hurtful for them. They felt like I didn't want to be around them, and nothing could have been further from the truth, but I didn't know how to enjoy them anymore. I didn't have a clue. I couldn't remember what it felt like to be happy. And just like Trisha said, I was just a barren tree. That's how I felt. Like I would never be happy again. A few days after the conversation with my husband, a friend sent me a text. I had inadvertently caused hurt to another one of our friends with something that I said. She was making me aware of it in a very loving way, that when you said this, this friend felt this way, and they would never come to you and say it because they don't want to make you feel bad, but you just might want to watch. And that was the tipping point for me. I already felt like I was letting everybody down. And then I found out that I had hurt one of my very, very dear friends. And that was the tipping point for me. I spun out big time. That night, I talked to my husband about how I was feeling. Like I was never going to get better. I cried. He sat beside me. He told me it was going to be okay. He told me he loved me. It was going to be okay. He did everything that he should have done that night. But I couldn't sleep. And eventually he drifted off to sleep. And I paced around our room for a little while. And I very resolutely decided that I was done. I was done. I was never going to be happy again. And my sadness was hurting everyone. My husband deserved to find and marry a funny, sweet girl full of life like I used to be. My kids deserved a stepmom who would appreciate how wonderful they are and love them like her own. Somebody would do it better than me. Anybody would do it better. And I decided very calmly that ending my life would be the best gift that I could give to the people I loved. That's a lie. I know that now. It's a lie. That night, when I couldn't sleep, I started making lists, writing letters, writing instructions, resigning myself to the idea that I was terminal. In my cognitive distortions, I was making everybody miserable. And I knew that my family would be sad initially when I was gone. But soon they'd see that I was leaving for them And I was leaving because I loved them too much to stick around. And someday they'd be happier. Don't ever let anybody tell you that suicide is selfish. It's not. It's the most heart-wrenching thought. But it is permanent, and it is destructive. And the butterfly effect of that decision will snuff out a beautiful, bright light in the world. So please, if that's where you are today, that's a lie that the world would be better off without you. It's a lie. The only thing that had kept me from going through with ending my life to that point was fear. Fear of the pain, fear of a failed attempt that would result in brain damage. And I felt selfish for being too afraid. But I knew that eventually that fear would subside and it would clear and I would make my exit. So I wrote letters to my children. I wrote instructions to my husband. I told him where everything would be, where all of the paperwork was, when the kids had music lessons, doctor's appointments that were coming up, the phone number for our youngest's behavioral therapist. Make sure that you fill their prescriptions when you've got about a week's worth of medicine left, because sometimes they can be slow. You know, all that stuff. Things that you do when somebody tells you you have 2 months to live. I was making plans. I was making sure that the transition would be as smooth as possible for my family. And then I started to write my letter to my husband because I knew he would know that it wasn't an accident. And I told him how sorry I was and how much I loved him. And I began to silently weep as he laid there beside me. And he woke up and he saw me writing and he said, "What are you writing?" I said, "Oh, I'm just journaling. I haven't done that in a while. I'm just kind of getting my thoughts on paper." And he got up out of bed and walked around to my side of the bed, and he got down on my knee, on his knees, and I will never forget the look in his eyes. If you know Evan at all, he's a super stoic guy, and he is not a crier, but his eyes just pooled. And he said, "Baby, what are you writing?" And I just broke. And he held my hand. He said, "I can't do this without you. I don't want to do this without you. I don't. I want you here." And I poured out of my heart how I just felt like, you don't know it right now, but you'll be better. And now looking back, I mean, the insanity of saying that to a person who's sitting in front of you begging you to stay, I didn't believe it. And he begged, "Please, you haven't even done everything you can. Please go talk to somebody." And so I said that I would. And I did it only because he found me. I was caught. But he saved my life. Because if he hadn't woken up, I would have just kept planning. God saw me that night, and he woke my husband up. And I'm so thankful. When I went and spoke with the therapist,
she asked me what was keeping me around right now. And I said, I'm afraid. And she said, good. I hope that you'll stay that way for a while. Let's get you into a program. So I started partial hospitalization. My first day, I sat in the group therapy room and I thought, this is so stupid. I don't even know why I'm here. And then I started working through my step one and had questions that prompted me to dig deep into those cognitive distortions, those lies that were keeping me depressed. And then I started to want to get better. And then a few weeks into the program, I wanted to get better. And I wanted to survive. And I do want to survive. And I want to say to you today that you are not alone. If you can hear my voice, and I know that it has shaken, but if you can hear the strength in my voice now, I am not healed, but I'm better. I'm not dying. I don't want to die. I want to be alive. That's a big deal for me. Yep. Oftentimes when we're depressed, we're told to reach out. And that's really hard to do when we're depressed because we already feel like we're a burden. Again, that's a lie. The people who love you want to know when you're struggling so they can help. But to those of you who are strong here, who are strong in mind and strong in spirit, if there is a friend or a family member that you've noticed withdrawing, please reach out to them. Send a text. I love you. I miss you. Invite them to coffee. Ask what you can do. The most important question that my husband has learned to ask me is, what do you need from me right now? That's been a really important question. And usually it's just, I just need the presence of a person next to me. And I just need to hear that he's not ever going to leave me. And sometimes that's just what we need. There are resources available to you, and I think Sarah put some brochures that I brought from the St. Vincent Stress Center. They're in the pockets of some of these chairs, and I didn't have enough to put in the back of every chair, but if you're struggling, grab one of those brochures. There's a crisis line on there 24 hours a day. You don't have to be suicidal to call it, but there are people that can help. I didn't think I had anything to talk about, but I did. And I'm never going to not need to take a pill every day. And I've learned to accept that. And I'm going to have really rotten days. And sometimes I'm not going to have a clue why. But I know that better days are coming. And I hope that, I know this is really heavy stuff, but I hope that as you're leaving today, that you will believe that better days are coming. I really hope that you believe that. And if you're having a hard time accepting that right now, then please call a counselor. There are all kinds of resources available to you. Thank you all for listening, and I love you.